Amen. To build up the saints of God to do the work of the ministry. Amen. Praise the Lord. Jeremiah 29, verse number 11 says, "For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end." The Amplified says, "For I know the thoughts and plans that I have for you, says the Lord. Thoughts and plans for welfare and peace and not for evil, to give you hope in your final outcome." Amen. We're talking from the subject matter of trusting the plan of God. Amen. Trust in the plan of God. Go over to Proverbs chapter 16. Proverbs chapter 16. And look at verse number 9. Proverbs chapter 16, verse number 9. Look what the word says. "A man's heart deviseth his way, but the Lord directed his steps." The Amplified says, a man's mind plans his ways, but the Lord directs his steps and makes them sure. Amen. So we got to go back and find out what is God's plan for our lives. God knew us before we ever came into existence, and he has a plan for our lives. And here's the thing. If the God of the universe can put the stars in place and the moon in place and the sun in space and have day and night, amen, certainly he's smart enough to know what you ought to be doing in this life, amen. Now, it's only up to us when we get to the place where we understand what God's plan is and then participate in God's plan. And we found out in 1 John that God's plans are not grievous. Amen. Amen. He says his plans are not for evil, but it's to bring you to an expected end. And I'm so excited about the plan of God for our lives. Now, again, I say we have to participate in God's plan, because one of God's plan is that we get saved. Salvation is the plan of God for our lives. The Bible says that he's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance, come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And so it is the will of God for every man, woman, boy, and girl to be saved. Now, it's up to us to participate in that plan by accepting Jesus as Lord and Savior. Amen. And it's so easy. The Bible says that if you would confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. You become a part of the plan of God for your life. Hallelujah. Then we found out that God has a plan for our success. I believe that everything we do ought to be successful. Amen. Whether it's in marriage, whether it's in parenting, whether it's on your job, whether it's, you know, whatever you do, the Bible says you should be prosperous. You should succeed. Amen. The Bible says that when you go out, when you come in the city and in the field, you ought to prosper. That you ought to be successful in everything that you do, because that's the will of God for his people. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, then on last week, we begin to talk about God says that he wants us to be, we want to trust the plan of God when it comes down to our substance. Somebody say substance. Amen. Now, again, I'm not ashamed to teach you this word. Amen. Now, I know there's been a big, big uproar going on in the body of Christ with some people saying that all they want is your money. Amen. Now, there is nobody who go to Walmart and say, all Walmart wants is my money. It's only when you come to the body of Christ and to the kingdom of God that people start to declare, all they want is your money. Well, first of all, let me just say this. It all belongs to him. We just stewards over what God has given us. None of this stuff is ours by ownership. It's ours by what? Stewardship. Praise the Lord. Amen. But we got to get beyond the misinformation. Because the devil wants you to believe that you ought to keep all your stuff. Amen. Because he wants you to be selfish and self-centered and not kingdom-minded. Amen. Amen. Then we talked about the revelation. We got a revelation on giving, because we said on last week that it all belongs to God. And God wants us to give as a matter of our heart. Amen. And not a matter of our mind. Amen. Then we found out that it's not equal gifts, but it's equal sacrifice. Not equal gifts, but equal sacrifice. When I get a revelation, amen, that it's not about how much I give, but that it's an equal sacrifice, amen. Then we found out that how I give it is how I'm going to receive it. If I ever get a revelation on how I give it, it's how I'm going to receive it. If I give little, I'll get little. If I give large, I'll get large. Amen. And it's not just about the money. Amen. Because I give, watch this now, and I give because I want to be happy in my marriage. Amen. And I got large at that. Look, I'm receiving large from that. Praise the Lord. We just celebrated 31 years a few days ago. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. And in 31 years, we haven't had an argument. Now, we disagree, but we haven't had an argument. Ain't no sense in raising your voice. We can disagree and keep our voices down. Amen. I don't believe in all that fussing and cussing and all that kind of stuff. Hey, listen, we disagree. Okay, now let's get to a point of agreement. Amen. Praise the Lord. So we found that out. Hallelujah. Now, go over to Romans chapter 8. Because we said that were going to be 4 points. The misunderstanding. The revelation on giving. Today we're going to deal with the resentment of giving. And then we're going to talk about the resolve of the giver. Amen. Because there's some people who resent giving. Amen. Well, why we always got to give, Pastor? Because that's what God said. Amen. And we're going to deal with that because we got to deal with our flesh. Somebody say flesh. See, your flesh is the first thing that wants to jump up at God when it comes down to giving to the kingdom of God. Because your flesh wants it all for itself. Amen. And if you don't get your flesh in line with what your spirit man wants to obey God, your flesh want to do its own thing. And your flesh will resent giving because it will think, look, we can heap this upon ourselves. Amen. Romans chapter 8. Look at verse number 5. Romans chapter 8, verse number 5, the resentment factor. Amen. It starts with your flesh. Look what it says in verse 5. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the spirit, the things of the spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. So here I find out that if I'm operating in the flesh, my flesh will resent the things of God, because it doesn't want to please God. Amen. Your spirit man's become alive to the things of God. That's what happens at salvation. Your flesh don't change. Amen. It's because your spirit now is more sensitive to the spirit of God that gets your flesh in line. Amen. And all of us got to deal with this flesh. Amen. As a matter of fact, the Bible says there's no good thing that dwelleth in the flesh. So all of us have to get this flesh under control because it will start resenting giving. Amen. Amen. Now, the second factor that causes people to resent giving is what I want to call the fear of lack. Amen. That if I give to the kingdom of God, that I will go lacking. Amen. Go to Psalms 34. See, most people think that if I give, God will not show up in time. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Because God, I have this thing pressing right now. And if I give like you require me to give, then will you show up for me? Man, I remember when Gwen and I were, this was Keisha's 27, so she's about to be 28, so 28 years ago, we went to Consumers Credit Bureau, CCS, Community Services, Consumer Credit Services. And we were so much in debt that we needed help. And so here, this was right when I made a commitment to God that God, I'm gonna be a tither. And they said, you can't do it because you got more bills than you have money coming in. And how are you gonna add 10% more of your income that you really don't have to give away to the kingdom of God? And you got all these bills pressing, so you're gonna go without. But I made a commitment. We made a commitment that God, from this day forward, that we're going to give according to the plan of God for our lives. In Psalms 34, watch this now. Psalms 34, look at verse number 10. Psalms 34, verse number 10. Hallelujah. Look what it says. The young lions do lack and suffer hunger, but they that seek the Lord shall not want any good thing. So the Bible declares that if I'm doing what God says, amen, I don't have to worry about the fear of lack because I was young, but now I'm old. I have never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. I don't have to worry about lack, because God's system says that if I give, it's going to be given unto me. It's that simple. Amen. The third thing that causes people to resent giving is what I want to call the flawed look. Amen. The flawed look, F-L-A-W-E-D, flawed, flawed look. Amen. Because we're looking at it from a natural perspective and not from a kingdom perspective. Amen. The prophet had to pray to God to open the servant's eyes, not from the natural, but from the spirit realm. Amen. The servant seen all the stuff in the natural. He seen that the enemies were around him. But what the prophet had to pray was, God, he needs to see more than what he sees right now. Amen. His eyes are wide open, but he's missing it. Amen. And there's so many believers that are in church whose eyes are wide open, but they're missing the spirit realm. Amen. And see, we have to see it from his perspective, that God's system truly does work. Anybody can attest to the fact that God's system works? Amen. 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 Now, we have to see it that it's more than just the seed that leaves my hand. Amen. It's a seed that's going to set up the harvest for my life. And if I don't see it from God's perspective, look, I'm going to miss out on giving. I'm going to resent giving because I don't see it like you see it, Pastor. Amen. I don't see it like you see it because I'm looking from this natural perspective. I'm looking at all my bills I got to pay. Amen. I'm looking at my light bill, my water bill, my car note. I'm looking at all that. But you don't see that it's God that's giving you the strength to do get all that stuff. Ooh, praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Then the next thing is, the reason why people resent giving is what I want to call the fraudulent lifestyle. The fraudulent lifestyle. Uh-huh. Yeah. See, people have a get-over mentality when it comes to the kingdom of God. Go to Malachi chapter 1. Malachi chapter 1. A fraudulent lifestyle. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. See, even the people back in the day thought they were getting over with God. Malachi chapter 1. Let's look at verse number 7. The fraudulent lifestyle. Amen. Always want the hookup. You know, want to buy the stuff out the back of the car. Amen. Yeah. I got something in the back of the car that you might want for $10. Amen. It looks good. But they stole it to get it to you. Oh, amen. Verse number 7. Look what the prophet says. Ye offer polluted bread upon my altar, and ye say, wherein have we polluted thee? In that ye say, the table of the Lord is contemptible. And if ye offer the blind for sacrifice, is it not evil? And if ye offer the lame and sick, is it not evil? Offer it now unto thy governor. Will he be pleased with thee or accept thy person, said the Lord of hosts? God says, you wouldn't give this to your boss. You want to give me the lame, the blind, and all the stuff that's poison. He said, go serve that to your boss. Serve it to the one that's on your job. You wouldn't do that, but you try to give that to me. You trying to give me the corruptible stuff. Ooh, Jesus, amen. You trying to give me all the leftovers. And God say, how you going to do that? Because of a fraudulent lifestyle. Amen. Hallelujah. The next thing why people resent giving, Sister Porter, is because of the fallout of lies. The fallout of lies. Amen. See, they have heard that money is the root of all evil. And that's not what the Bible says. Amen. It says the love of money is the root of all evil. If you love money more than you love God, then you got a problem. Amen. But because we have allowed Satan to corrupt our thinking, the Bible calls it blind in the minds of those who don't believe, then you will accept the lie before you accept the truth. That's why so many people fight me when it comes down to giving and prosperity, because they don't know the truth. Amen. If they would just see the word of God for themselves and see that this is God's plan and not man's plan, that they will honor God with their giving. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 2. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Watch this now. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Look at verse number 11. 2 Corinthians chapter number 2. verse number 11. Watch this now. Lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. See, the devil is trying to hoodwink the believer into not giving, because they know that if they give according to the plan of God, God's got their back. Amen. And see, that's what happens. The devil comes in and tries to cause somebody to fall in the body of Christ. Amen. And make you think that everybody is like that. Now, when we were growing up in church, you know, man, I've seen preachers act like the church account was their own personal check account. Amen. And not the kingdom of God. So what the devil will do is they'll say that all the preachers are like that. Amen. And so because of that, now he'll build up a lie to make you believe that everybody's just the same. Preachers had girlfriends on the side. Amen. And then they'll start saying all the preachers are just like that. It's a lie. I don't have no girlfriend. I got one girlfriend. She's sitting right over there. She's my girlfriend, my wife, and my lover. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. That's okay. Don't worry about it. Hey, I got this thing. Amen. But because we allow the devil to lie, because he's the father of the lie, and we don't address the issue, amen, then when something comes up in the body of Christ, everybody like, okay, well, he must be lying. Okay, give you an example. I don't personally have a problem with Jesse having a plane. Amen. Well, whatever. If he needs a plane to get him from one continent to the next continent, it's only a tool, man. And everybody tripping about him having a plane to get from one continent to the next. So watch this now. If they tripping with him to have a plane, they're going to trip with you for having a car. Everything is relative. Amen. See, they were messing with my apostle in Houston with the helicopter. Why do you need a helicopter? Because he's about to kill somebody on the beltway trying to get to another location. So now that he can fly over the mess and get to the next location to preach, who got a problem with that? It's only when we allow the devil to define how we ought to operate in the kingdom of God. Amen. So when you look at how God designed the system, listen, everybody can participate at your own level. Ooh, praise the Lord. Amen. And really, you got to understand that money is just a tool. Ecclesiastes chapter 7. Come on, let's go there. I'm going to have to show you. Ecclesiastes chapter 7. It's only a tool, man. Hallelujah. It's only a tool. It's a defensive tool against what the enemy is trying to put out into this world system to cause people not to be saved. You ready? Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse number 12. For wisdom is a defense, and money is a defense, but the excellency of knowledge is that wisdom giveth life to them that have it. So money is a defensive weapon against the enemy. Amen. And so if I have a resentment in my heart to give to the kingdom of God, like he says, then look, the enemy gonna run rapid. Amen. For instance, I believe that we ought to take over all the airwaves. I truly believe that. I don't care what airwave it is, I believe we ought to take over it. Whether it's radio, whether it's television, whether it's the internet, I believe the body of Christ ought to take over. Amen. But we have ceded that avenue to the devil because we don't want to get no money for it. Because it costs money. Amen. Yeah, it does. It costs money for that. I thank God for live stream, but guess what? They send us a bill every month. Amen. Now, we're able to hit 200 countries at one time. But guess what? It costs money. Amen. You think they're giving these lights for free? Energy? They don't give us these lights for free. Every month. Glory to God. Amen. Another reason why people resent giving is because of what their family said. Your family can corrupt you in your giving. Yeah. Your family can't corrupt you in your giving. See, if you are trained, see, we were trained to be givers. My mama trained us to give. She gave us a few nickels, you know, sometimes we didn't give them all, but she gave us a few nickels on the side. That, look, there used to be a store called Jerry Jiffy's. And growing up, mama would give us a few quarters to put in church. Well, you know, Jerry was right around the corner. And Jerry had some now or laters, some sugar babies, some red hots, or some Boston baked beans. Amen. But she taught us how to give. But there are some families who think that giving is not good for you. And if you're not careful, your family can talk you out of obeying God. Amen. The last thing why people resent giving is the fortunes of leadership. The fortunes of leadership. Even in Jesus' day, there were even those around him, Clint, that had a problem with Jesus receiving. You remember when Mary came and she broke the alabaster box over Jesus and poured the oil on Jesus? And one of his disciples, Judas, say, "Why are you wasting that?" They had a problem with Jesus receiving. Amen. And watch this now. One of the things that Lady Gwen and I did when we first built our house, if those of you could remember, we brought all of y'all to our house. Remember that? I brought everybody to the house. Everybody come out to the house. See, well, how will you pass a living? Because I don't want you to think I'm stealing your money. I'm bold enough to ask you for it. But we don't live our life based upon what people say. We live based upon how we give. If I go back and look at what Gwen and I have given to this ministry only, our house would have been paid for. Amen. So when people think that the pastor is stealing the money and he has a lavish lifestyle based upon, you know, what people think, they don't know us. Because I go pull my giving record right now. And we're over the 300,000 mark right now that we've given to this ministry. And watch this, without a secular job. Amen. No, see, y'all understand. See, we gave like this after I left Mobile. Amen. I was already gone from Mobile. So they can't say that I gave that money while I was working there. Now, I did give when I was at Mobile, but I'm talking about after we left Mobile. Ooh, Jesus. Amen. And some people won't give because they're saying, well, the pastor getting all y'all money. And I'm like, Lord, that's why people resent giving. Okay, you would think that people would want the pastor to be experiencing God's best because it sets in motion for you to receive God's best. Amen. Think about it for a second. If I'm teaching faith and prosperity and this thing ain't working for me, why y'all here? You'll be like, amen. No. I'm talking about loving your wife, and then Sister Lady Gwen come in here and she got black eyes and all that kind of stuff. Y'all be like looking like this ain't working for him. Amen. I mean, this thing ain't working. He talking about giving, but it ain't coming back to him. Something wrong with that picture. Amen. But if you think that because of the fortunes of leadership that you ought not give, then look, here's a promise that God has made. That when I give, what? I shall receive. That you got to make that a personal thing for you. Amen. That's what happened with Lady Gwen and I. We made this thing personal. God, if this thing is going to work, it's going to work for us. Woo! So we're going to participate in your plan and watch it. Watch you manifest all your promises. Yes. Amen. Yes. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Yes. Mm-hmm. Amen. Now watch this now. So let's talk about the resolve of the giver. The resolve of the giver. Go to Luke chapter 6. I made a resolution to God that I will be principal conscience. Principal conscience. Amen. How many of you know that the law of gravity works? All right. The law of gravity says that if you jump, you know, you're going to fall 32 feet per second. It's a law. Giving is a law. And you got to look, you have to be principal conscience that this is God's system and it's going to work for me. What does Luke 6:38 says? Read that aloud. Give and it shall be given unto you. What? Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and what? Running over, what? Shall men give unto your bosom, what? For with the same measure that you meet with all, it shall be measured to you again. That's what the word says, right? Okay, so if I'm principled conscience, then I will understand that if I give, it has to be given back to me. That's the principle. Amen? And I'm not satisfied with just giving and not having an expectation to receive. I used to be like that. Yeah, I did. I used to be a good giver with no expectation of receiving. And then I had to get checked in my spirit that this is a principle, that if I give, it got to be given back to me. So now I expect for people to give to me. Amen. Praise the Lord. Secondly, I have to be persecution conscious. When I make a resolve to be a giver, I have to be persecution conscious. Go to Mark chapter 10. See, you cannot stop people from talking about you. Amen. Everybody will not applaud you for obeying God. Amen. As a matter of fact, there will be some people who will aggressively criticize you, put you on blast. Amen. But if you know that you're going to be persecuted, hey, just water off a duck's back. Amen. Mark chapter 10. Watch this now. Mark chapter 10. Praise the Lord. Amen. Look at verse number 28. Mark chapter 10, verse number 28. You ready? Look what he says. Then Peter began to say unto him, lo, we have left all and follow thee. And Jesus answered and said, verily I say unto you, there's no man that hath left house or brethren or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my sake and the gospel, but he shall receive a hundredfold now in this time, houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecution, and in the world to come, eternal life. So look, I'm already resolved that, listen, I know people gonna talk about me. Amen. They're gonna talk about what I have, they're gonna talk about what I drive, they're gonna talk about what I wear. I understand they're gonna do that. Amen. But look, I'm going to get the hundredfold, and I'm going to get it now. Somebody say now. In this time. Amen. And then I'm going to get eternal life. So I'm not going to let you, what you say about me, stop me from having eternal life. And I'm not going to let you talk about me, about having the prosperity now. Amen. Hallelujah. You know what God does for me sometimes? God will tell me to go bless the person that's talking about me. I say, what? He said, yeah, him right there, he's talking about you. Go put a seed in his hand. And it trips him out. It trips him out. Because the Spirit of God spoke to him and said, go bless them. Knowing that they're the one persecuting you. See, the Bible says, listen, don't think it's strange when persecution comes. If they persecuted Jesus, they're going to persecute you. But you got to have a persecution conscience. I understand. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer what? You're going to be persecuted. You're going to be persecuted in the house you drive. You're going to be persecuted in the car you drive. Listen, you're going to be persecuted on a vacation you take. You're going to be persecuted. Amen. So look, when you're driving your RV, who they think they are? They could have got one of the motels. I didn't want a motel. I wanted to drive this RV. And watch this. Shh, quiet as kept. Most of the persecutors are in your family. Most persecuted is in your family. Because they can't understand how you got out the projects and you're living the way you live, and they still there. Number next, the resolve of the giver is I'm prosperity conscious. Amen. I know that my giving is the pathway to my prosperity. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Amen. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Yeah, I'm principal conscious. I'm a persecution conscious, but I'm also prosperity conscious. Amen. Debbie, you remember way back when I had this picture on my wall in my room? It said, I ain't going to tell y'all what it said, but it had a man with a Rolls Royce. He was cool, too. He was standing next to a Rolls Royce, and he had riding boots on, and he had his foot on the Rolls Royce like this, and I had it on my wall because I was prosperity conscious. I always wanted to be rich. Amen. But God's showing me how to be rich his way. Amen. Amen. See, don't get mad at me because you decide to go some other route to get your wealth. I'm depending on the Spirit of God to make me wealthy. As a matter of fact, he said, I gave you the power to get it. So if he gave you the power to get it, you might as well get it. Somebody say, get it. Okay. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Watch this. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Look at verse number 6. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse number 6 says, but this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give not grudgingly of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work. So I'm prosperity conscious. Amen. I believe that the favor of God comes on my life as a result of my giving. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Okay. Not only am I prosperity conscious, but watch this now. I'm posterity conscious. Posterity conscious. In other words, watch this now. I know that my giving is going to affect generations. Amen. Go to Proverbs chapter 20. See, most times, okay, in our culture, as black people, our forefathers have said things like this: I got mine, you get yours. I had to come up the rough way, you got to come up the rough way. But when I am a resolved giver, I am posterity conscious that my children and my grandchildren shouldn't have to have the same struggle I had. Amen. See, this what changes my mindset when it comes down to giving. Because Keisha and Matthew don't have to experience the same thing I experienced. And bless God, when they get married and have children, that their children will not have to go through what they went through. Because my grandma and papa, whatever they're going to call us, we're going to send them back loaded. Glory to God, amen. They're going to be like, no, we don't want to come on. We want to stay with papa. We want to stay with him. Amen. They give us everything. Watch this, though. Watch this. You got to be posterity conscious. See, you got to stop thinking about just you, but the generations that's going to come up after you. Proverbs chapter 20 and verse number 7. Watch this now. The just man walketh in his integrity. His children are blessed after him. So my children will get the overflow of my giving to God. Watch this now. Because one, I've trained them how to give. Amen. And two, because of what God is doing in our lives, they get the benefit of it. You know, once a year we take a family vacation. And we take the whole family on vacation. And I tell my children, this is what God has provided for you. So they always recognize that God did this. Because I want generation after generation after generation to see this was God. Go over to Proverbs 13. Proverbs 13. Watch. Watch this now. Proverbs 13. I have to be posterity conscious. Amen. Think about my children. Well, see, the people that don't give, they say, well, I'm thinking about my children, too. Okay, but are you operating in God's plan for your life? Proverbs 13, verse 22. A good man leaveth an inheritance to his what? Children's children, and the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. So when I am posterity conscious, I'm not thinking about the next generation. But I'm thinking about the next generation after the next generation, after the next generation, after the next generation. Amen. My children's children. So when I'm posterity conscious, that's why every man, every father in here, listen to me, fathers. Listen to this real quick. Listen to this, fathers. Every father in here should have life insurance. Thank you. Thank you. Two, three people, four people. Every father in here ought to have life insurance, because you're thinking about the next generation and the next generation. Man, it don't make any sense for you to have rims on your car and no insurance. I mean, you got to look. We were coming down the street the other day. They had this guy with these big old wheels, the wheels sticking out, almost ran us off the road. But I guarantee you probably don't have no insurance on his life. Now, we plan to live a long life, but my God, when we get to 123, that policy ought to be jacked up by the time we get there. Hallelujah. They shouldn't be questioning how we're going to bury you. Amen? I mean, they have to borrow from this person and that person just to get you in the ground. That shouldn't happen. Amen? If you're thinking about generations, amen, to come, you ought to have life insurance. Glory to God, amen? So fathers, for your Father's Day gift today, on tomorrow, go find you some life insurance. The younger you are, the better it is. Amen. Start now. Amen. So not only am I principle conscious, not only am I persecution conscious, not only am I prosperity conscious and posterity conscious, but I'm also purpose conscious. Amen. The resolve of the giver has to be purpose conscious. Go to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter number 2. Hallelujah. I'm purpose conscious. Ephesians chapter number 2. See, I understand that the purpose, there's a purpose to my giving. There's some good work I have to do. Amen. Ephesians chapter 2. Look at verse number 10. Ephesians chapter 2. Verse number 10. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God had before ordained that we should walk in them. The Amplified says, for we are God's own handiwork, his workmanship, recreated in Christ Jesus, born anew, that we may do those good works which God predestined, planned beforehand for us, taking paths which he prepared ahead of time, that we should walk in them, living the good life which he prearranged and made ready for us to live. So I am purpose conscious, knowing that I got to do some good work. So when it comes down to my giving, I know that my giving is doing some good work. Woo, Jesus, amen. Hallelujah. And so when I'm purpose, see, I understand God has a purpose. That's why I told God, Father Charles, God, I thank you that you will flood my life with resources. Why? For a purpose. I'm gonna be a channel in which you can flow money to and through. Amen. On purpose. Hallelujah. Okay. Woo. How can I put this? Yeah. See. I have this desire to bless folk, man. I have this desire to bless folk, man, with stuff that they would know that God had a hand in it. Well, God's gonna get the credit. Amen. Just out of the blue, glory to God. Just being able to bless somebody. Man, we have already blessed people with houses and cars. Amen. It's the joy of my life to give to folk. Amen. It is the joy of my life to be able to bless somebody else. Bless somebody just out of the blue. That God said, give you a house. You say, what? He told me to give you a house. He told me to give you a car. And now watch this now. Because I'm posterity conscious, when Keisha came up and said, Daddy, God told me to give a call away, I'm like, go ahead, girl, you do your thing. Because she understood, this is what we do. But we give on purpose. On purpose, amen? The next thing I have to be, if I'm going to resolve my giving, Sister Porter, is I have to be project conscious. Project conscious. In other words, when it comes down to building the kingdom of God, and all the things that go with that, I have to be project conscious. In other words, when God told Moses to build the tabernacle, he goes to the people and says, hey, we got a project. And God wants all of us to participate in the project. Now, those who have a willing heart, you'll participate. Amen. That's how we're able to do all the stuff we do. Man, you know, pastors are amazed about our church. They ask, well, Sharp, how many folks you got? Well, they say running. How many folks you running? I understand why we don't understand. We can't run sheep. But anyway, y'all get the gist of that. And then they ask, well, Sharp, how much money y'all receive? I tell them, and they like, oh, my God. Y'all done that? I say, yeah. With that many people? Uh-huh. And then they look at what we're able to do and our reach and our touch, our global touch, and they like, man, you know, because we are project conscious. Look, I would rather take a handful of committed folk than a church of non-committed people to get things done for the kingdom of God. Amen? Because there's a project. Amen? So whenever there's a project, you know, we have to give. Now, how many of y'all received my text message on this past week? Amen? Y'all received my text message? Okay. Last year, we began our summer stretch seed. Amen? And what we did was we eliminated kingdom debt. All right? Now, this year, what we're going to do, we have to upgrade. We've been having these cameras, for a long time. It's time for us to upgrade them. And so what we're going to do with some of that money is we're going to upgrade all of our systems. Y'all see how Pastor Mike going out and all that kind of stuff? I've been changing mics. Give me that mic. We can't do that. Amen? So when we give our summer stretch seed for this project, guess what? Now we're going to participate with God's plan. Amen? And look, we will see the benefit from the kingdom perspective when we give. So I'm expecting all of us to give. Amen? Now, so some of you who didn't raise your hand for getting my text message, well, what was the text message, Pastor? Amen? You have that text message up? You have that message up there? I'm going to show y'all the message that I sent y'all. Yeah. Huh? It's not in your system? Well, I have it on my laptop right here. Well, I can't send it to you, can I? Yeah. All right. I'm going to show y'all. Yeah, I get it to him. But I'm going to send it out again so y'all can see it. On next Sunday, we'll have it available to you to see it on the screen. But, yeah, I believe that because of the project, we're going to get involved. Amen. So watch this now. So I am principle-driven. I am persecution conscious. I am prosperity conscious. Come on, what's the next one? Posterity conscious. What's the next one? Purpose conscious. And the next one? Project. And the last one for the day is, I'm promise conscience. Amen. God has made us some promises, man. That would be one thing if Glenn made us promises that if we give, it's going to be given back to you. Now, Glenn is just a man just like me. We subject to change. But since God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, his promises never change. Go to Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6. Amen. I'm promise conscious because God made me a promise. Amen. This is why I live the way I live, because God made me a promise. And this is why I'm so confident in the word of God, because God said this. God inspired man to write this about himself. And he said, here are some promises to you as a giver. Amen. Galatians chapter 6. Look at verse number 6. Galatians chapter 6, verse number 6. Let him that is taught in the word communicate unto him that teacheth in all good things. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever man soweth, that shall he reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall do what? Reap if we faint not. As we therefore have opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. So God says, here's a promise for you. If you sow, you shall reap. If you sow, you shall reap. So God, I am a sower, then I am a reaper. Amen? Because his promise is that if I sow it, man, I'm going to reap it. Ooh, Jesus, amen. When I found that promise, Javon, it changed everything, man. So it took all of the people out of the equation for me. Because I'm not, look, it's all about me and Lady Gwen. If we're sowers, we're going to reap. That's how I took it. I looked at this thing and I said, hey, man, this is for me. This is a personal thing for me. And look, I'm going to be involved in God's plan. Amen? Man. So I looked at the promise. When I looked at the promise of tithing, God says he's going to open the windows of heaven, pour me out a blessing that they won't have room enough to receive it. He says he's going to rebuke the devourer for my sake, and all nations going to call me blessed. I say, ooh, look at the promises in that thing. Amen? When it came down to give it to my man of God, it says, watch this now, but my God shall supply all my need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. That's a promise for me. Amen? So now, if I participate in that part of God's plan, then I can expect the promise. Because it's his plan. Okay? He says, I'm not like you, TJ, that I should lie. I'm not like y'all. If I said it, I'm going to come through with it. So I got 66 books to tell me about God. That's why I get upset when people say that God is mysterious. How are you going to be mysterious and write 66 books about how you operate? How are you going to be mysterious? No, I go to the Word of God. I find out here's the character of God. Here's the plan and purpose of God. And God, this is your system. If you said this should work, I'm going to work it. Ooh, Jesus, amen. And some of y'all could testify. Some of y'all could testify to the fact that you participated in God's plan, and man, you have seen the return. And watch this now. Thank you. And look, those of you who are trying ain't going to get it. I can tell you that right now. Because the devil going to give you every excuse for why you shouldn't do it. I tried it, Pastor. This is something you have to commit to. Amen. But if you promise conscience, okay, I have 2 minutes. I had a pastor friend of mine came talk to me one time. He said, Sharp, my people not giving. I said, okay. I said, let me ask you a question. How are you teaching giving? And he told me how he taught it. I said, man, that's a little rough. I mean, you beating up on the people of God. I say, why don't you do this? Why don't you teach them the promise of their giving versus you beating up on them? He say, huh? I say, hey, man, my deal is I tell y'all what God said, and that's up to y'all after that. I ain't mad at nobody. Because guess what? Y'all ain't going to stop Lady Gwen and I. Amen. No, because we already participated in the plan. But watch this now. Once I tell you, show you the promise that God made for your giving, then that's up to you. Amen. Now, you do whatever you want to do after that. Amen. And look, watch this. Not one time in 17 years have we marched y'all around to give. Not one time. So I told him, I say, show them the benefit. Show them the benefit of their giving. And when you show them the benefit of their giving, you let God work on their hearts. Amen. All I can do is just show you the word. That's all I can do. Amen. Now, some of us got to a place of struggle that we cried out to God and said, God, look, you got to help us. And then God said, okay, well, now, here's what you need to do. You need to obey the word, do what God says, and I'll deliver you out of that mess. Amen. Hallelujah. But you got to be promise conscious. God, what did you promise me on my giving? Hallelujah. And if I operate in his plan, I promise you, man, he gonna come through. Yeah, he will. Yeah, he will. God will come through. Praise the Lord. Amen. All right. Now, next week and the week after, I'm going to end the series on the plan of God for our lives. Okay? Next week, I'll talk about God's plan for your service. See, I just don't believe you ought to be sitting in church doing nothing. Everybody ought to do something. Okay? Then finally, we're going to end up with the plan of God for your situation. See, many people are going through situations, and God has a plan to get you out of it. Amen? God has a plan for you. But I received that. God has a plan for you to get out your situation, but you got to obey God's plan. You know, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13 talks about he makes a way of escape for you. Well, if his plan is to get you out, but you don't take the path, whose fault is that? See, some people like swimming in their misery. Yeah, don't show me the way out, Pastor, because I like this stuff. But God has a plan for every one of your situations. Amen? And we're going to show you that in the next couple of weeks. Amen? But I got to stop because guess what? I am out of town. Give God a big hand of praise. Amen?